Thank you. Did you need me to do anything else with it? Just, is this sufficient? Is this... Okay. This... Perfect. And then, Mark, I'll come out to this side so that I can pull the computer off this way.
Good evening, and welcome to this live stream XLT here at St. Timothy Catholic Church. We invite you wherever you are, wherever you're joining in, to join in lifting up your voice, opening up your hearts, and joining in praise.
Hallelujah.
Good evening, and welcome to our, to my knowledge, very first St. Timothy XLT live stream. My name is Megan Martinez. I'm the Director of Youth Ministry here at the parish, and I have the privilege of welcoming you into our church. It's the weirdest experience I've ever experienced right now. Being in this church with empty pews, many of us left here almost exactly a month ago, not quite realizing what life was about to look like. But Easter is here. The Lord is risen. The church is still here. The Lord is still here. And tonight we are so excited to pray together. That's why we really wanted to work hard to make this event live. So right now, even if you are on your device on YouTube, there's a little share option. We really invite you to share this with someone right now. It's not too late. We know everyone's home. So share this with someone who you think might enjoy a little bit of prayer time, who might benefit with a little bit of time with the Lord tonight. We're going to have a chance to continue to pray in with song. We're going to have a message by Mark Hart in a little bit. And then we'll have a chance to adore the Lord in the Eucharist, which is a really unique and cool opportunity just to be as present as possible with the Lord, who's as present as possible with us. So I encourage you to send that invitation, send the text, send the link, and see what happens. See what God does with your invitation to someone else. We want to take just a second to see if you are online with us, to type in where are you watching from as well right now. We know that several of you are out here in the East Valley around Mesa and Gilbert, especially if you're watching from anywhere else around the country tonight. Type into the chat, let us know. I'll kind of be doing a managing of the chat tonight as we go, so feel free to chime in. Let us know as well what we can pray for you. What are your intentions? What are the things that you are seeing in the world around you that need prayer? And how can we come together and pray as one church tonight? You're also welcome to tag St. Timothy on your Instagram account. We'd love to feature you on our stories tonight, just as you, if you're with your family, if you're with your roommates, if you're by yourself, maybe it's easier for you to pray like this tonight, just with your earbuds in your room. That's great. That's cool. Tag us on Instagram at St. Timothy Mesa, and we'd love to feature you there. All right, looks like we've got mostly people watching from Phoenix chiming in on our chat. It's good to have you. It's great for you to be here. Someone from California, all right, good job. That's fantastic. The technology here gives us a whole new ballgame to work with, which means that we can reach the gospel further into the world right now, which is really an amazing thing. Someone watching from Mexico, this is beautiful. This is fantastic right here. So tonight, we invite you to pray. However that looks for you in your situation, we want to come together as one church and pray together. So if that means dancing around your living room with the music, praise the Lord. If that means finding a quieter place away from all the people who you've been sharing your home with, feel free to do that. If you want to grab a Bible, maybe even a journal that will help you kind of to hear the Lord speak in your life, that would be wonderful. Here, these are still rolling in. Someone is watching from the Philippines. That's amazing. From New England, from California, here more California, and then Ohio. This is beautiful, guys. This is fantastic. The Lord is not done working just because we're not together physically. And I really want to invite you into that faith tonight, that the Lord is working in our lives, in our churches, in our homes, in our family. And we want to pray with great faith. Amen? So tonight, let's lean into that. Let's pray for God to do big things in our lives, in our world, but more importantly, in our hearts. So join me in prayer in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Jesus, we trust in you. We trust in your design and your plan. Help us to see the ways that you are working and the ways that you invite us into your work in the world. The ways that you invite us to speak your name, to share your truth, to receive your love. Come, Holy Spirit.
And I believe you've overcome.
how I fight my battles. This is how. In the valley, I know that you're with me. Surely your goodness and your mercy follow me. So my weapons are praise and thanksgiving. This is how I fight my battles. Right now, we come before you. Wherever it is that we are right now, we know that where we are is where you placed us. Many of us are at home, and we know that that home is a place that you have placed us, that you have provided for us. That's where you've called us to be. Not only because of the situation right now, you call us to be home. But you call us to be where exactly it is that we are. Because you have a plan for us. You have a plan for those around us. You have a plan for this whole world. And we don't see that plan right now, God. We don't see that plan. Some of us say we don't even see it at all. Some of us say all we see is darkness. Some of us say all that we see is loneliness. Some of us say all we see is even depression, anxiety, fear. And we speak into all of those that you have already conquered, that you've already conquered by your death. Even the greatest of fears, death itself, you have conquered. And so we lift up all of our fears, all of our anxieties right now. We lift it up to you, Lord, who on the cross conquered death itself, suffered death, and rose to new life. And so we pray right now, God, we're crying out to you for that new life. We're crying out to you. We're turning to you because we know that you are God. We know that you created the earth. We know that you created every cell in the universe. We know that you created everything, and you can have it all in your hand, Lord. You have it all in your heart. And so we pray now, pour out your love in us. Pour out your love in us. Pour out your spirit in us. We're crying out to you, God. Pour out. And as we cry out, let this be our battle cry. Let this be our praise. Let this be our weapon of singing into those fears right now. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. Sing into all of that. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. Sing into his love. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. Surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. Wherever you, we are, you are. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. So we cry to you, God. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. You're with us, God. It may look
surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. So come, Holy Spirit, pour out your love. So come, Holy Spirit, you are here, moving in our midst. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you, I worship you. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are. Darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, touching every heart. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, healing every heart. I worship. Turning lives around, I worship you, I worship you. You are here, mending every heart, I worship you, I worship you. You are way maker, miracle worker, stop working, you never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Who you are.
They are right now. You have not left us abandoned. You have not left us alone. You have not left us without hope. So, Lord, we ask you tonight to speak to our hearts, to speak a word that would come from your lips into our hearts. That tonight, this Thursday night, in this April 16th, in this middle of this quarantine, whatever it is, that you can work miracles. That's not too big for you. That's not too hard for you. That is who you are. Help us to believe that. Help us to trust that. Help us to encounter your love in a new and a more profound way, even tonight, even in this moment. Thank you, Lord, as we pray together in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. It's really beautiful to see some of these prayer requests rolling in, praying for conversion of others, praying for healing, praying for surrender, praying for ourselves, praying for those dear to us. Prayers coming in from all over the world, literally, right now, as we pray together. In just a few moments, we're going to have a message from Mark Hart. He's going to talk about the light in the darkness, how the darkness is not stronger than the light, that the light overcomes it. And then we'll move into an opportunity for adoration, because we don't know where we're streaming into right now. Maybe you are at home and you have never seen Catholics pray like this. Maybe you have never prayed with Catholics or in adoration. Maybe you're standing in line at Chick-fil-A right now. I'm not sure what's going on in your life, but wherever you are, we want to welcome you into this moment. After Mark speaks, we'll have a time of adoration. It's an opportunity to be truly present with the Lord who's truly present to us in his body and blood, soul and divinity in the Eucharist. And so there'll be an opportunity for some silence and some additional praise and worship as we place Jesus on the altar in a monstrance. And we trust that he is truly present because he promises us that he's truly present, specifically in John 6. And so tonight, if you want to grab a Bible to be able to pray along through some of this time with, or a journal, feel free to do that. Now is a good time. We're really blessed tonight to have an opportunity to have Mark Hart speak with us. He's the Vice President of Life Teen International. He's an acclaimed author, and we're really fortunate that he's able to be here tonight to share God's word with us. So let's welcome up Mark.
It's really a blessed but weird thing to walk into your home parish that you're so accustomed to always seeing so full and see it so empty. And I know I speak on behalf of a lot of people. That was a hard Holy Week and a hard Easter, not getting to be at Mass, not getting to receive the Lord in his body, blood, soul, and divinity, like Megan was saying. And it might feel right now, it definitely feels for a lot of us like darkness is winning. Like there's just a lot of darkness in the world, the darkness of death, the darkness of disease, the darkness of fear and stress and anxiety, whether that's for those who are caring for those who are sick or those who are working all the extra hours or those who are just in solitude and in loneliness and stuck at home and stuck inside. They make it bright, sunny day outside, but it still feels dark inside the home, maybe dark inside your heart right now. You're wondering where the God is and where he's gone and if he's still with us. I remember the first time I really realized how afraid I was of the dark. I was a little guy, and my nightlight went out. Now, if you're a child and you're accustomed to a nightlight, you know what happens when you don't have it. All of a sudden, you are really, really aware of how dark it was. And to make things worse, when I was a kid, I had just seen this movie called Poltergeist, and it scared the living everything out of me. I mean, this was the scary, and in the movie, there's this kid, and he's in his bed, and there's a storm outside, and the storm is raging, and the lightning would flash, and it would light up his room, but then it would go dark again, and he was so petrified. And after that movie, I wanted to sleep with the lights on every night, you know, until, well, I still do, I mean, for the last several years. But when that happened, I never forgot it. I was so scared, because in the darkness, you don't know what to expect. You don't know what's going to happen next. You can't control it, and you can't control how long the darkness lasts. And I remember that when that nightlight went out, I did not know what to do, and I could not sleep. I almost had just insomnia. And I went to my father, and I told him the nightlight was out. And rather than going to the store to get me a new one, because he'd had a long day, he said, "I'll tell you what I'm going to do, buddy. I'm going to leave the light on in my room. You leave your door open. When you see that the light's on in my room, you'll know that I'm with you, that I'm awake." Now, my dad didn't get a nightlight for several months, so that forced him to leave the light on every single night in his room, where I could see the light coming from the crack of the door or from beneath the door. In truth, I think if I would have walked up and knocked on the door or listened closely, he would have been asleep during the whole thing. The light was on, but he was sleeping. He was probably snoring. Why do I mention all this? Because in these moments, we as Catholics, we as Christians, we are prepared for these moments because we have a God who is light. Our God is a God of light. What's the very first thing that he says, that he speaks in Genesis? Yes, Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth was a formless wasteland, and darkness covered the abyss, while a mighty wind swept over the waters. Darkness covered us. We were in the dark. And then what does God say? The first thing he says, fiat lux, let there be light. And he breathes light. And everywhere God goes, the light goes with him. When his children, the Israelites, are wandering in the desert for 40 years, what does he do? At night, he goes before them as a pillar of light. When Jesus comes, go to John chapter 1. Go to John chapter 1, verse 5. It says, a light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. Some translations say the darkness cannot comprehend it. This is a classic and epic battle that goes on since the very, very beginning. The name Lucifer means light bearer. He was trying to put himself on par with God, who is light. But we all know that he is the king and the prince of darkness. And where darkness goes, evil lurks. But even through those moments of darkness, go throughout the Gospels. What does Jesus say? John 8, I am the light of the world. He stands and proclaims this. He goes to Bartimaeus, a man born blind, trapped in darkness. What does he do? He spits. He basically opens his eyes miraculously. And what can Bartimaeus for the first time see? Light. But who's he staring at after he's healed? He's staring at the light of the world. When the apostles are stuck in the storm at sea, they've been paddling for 9 hours. It's the third watch. It's 3:00 in the morning. The heavens are blanketed on the Sea of Galilee. They can't see the stars. They can't see the moon. Professional sailors are screaming like little Girl Scouts who just had their cookies stolen. And as these professional sailors are afraid of dying and they lose their mind, what happens? In the midst of this darkness, on the water walks the light. And when he walks and the light comes and he breathes on them and saves them, that even in the darkest hours of Good Friday, we thought that the darkness had won, had overcome. But that didn't extinguish the light because God was still with us. And on Easter morning, if you listen closely a few days ago to that reading on Easter morning, it says Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and she arrived there when? Early in the morning while it was still dark. You see, it was even in the darkness of Holy Saturday, in the darkness of Easter Sunday morning, before the sun rose, the sun rose, that the tomb moved away not to allow light in. It was still dark outside. The tomb was moved away to allow the light out, the light of the world out. And see, it's easy to forget. I'm sure that many of you, like me, have struggled in this past month, these many weeks, have struggled being away from your community. Maybe you've been struggled being too close with your loved ones. It's easy to spread darkness. It's hard to be a light in these times, even in our own homes where we're called to be a light first and foremost. My brothers and my sisters, God has not abandoned us. He will never abandon us. It goes against his very nature. Why? Because God is a God who desires to be with us. If he didn't, we wouldn't be here. The very first name we have for God, you know, in Matthew, for Jesus, Emmanuel, which means what? God with us. So right there in the first chapter of Matthew, 1:23, his name is Emmanuel, God with us. St. Matthew's trying to communicate something to us, that when God, when Christ came, that the glory of God comes with him, the light of God comes with him, for he is the second person of the Trinity. And not only that, he doesn't just begin his gospel with it. Matthew bookends his gospel with it, all the way in Matthew 28, the last thing he says, 28:20, and I'll be with you always. I'll be with you. Matthew's trying to tell us a very important truth, to remind us of a very important truth. From the very beginning to the very end of his story, God is with us. He's never abandoned us. He couldn't abandon us. So even when it feels like the darkness is winning, when it feels like the darkness is overcoming, we remember these words from sacred scripture. And that's a funny word, remember. You see, for the Jews, to remember something was not just to, oh, I recall it. Oh, yeah, that happened one time long ago. No. For our Jewish brothers and sisters, the idea, the art of remembering went far deeper than that. To remember meant to become one member with again. It's almost like going inside of yourself and going back in time to that specific moment and being there, being alive in it, being connected again. It was more than just looking at a picture. It was almost like going back in time and reconnecting. And that's why throughout the Old Testament, God is constantly telling the Israelites what? He's saying, remember. Remember what I led, what happened when I led you out of Egypt. Remember what happened when we crossed the River Jordan and went into Jericho. Remember, remember. I used to say to myself, reading the Old Testament, I used to say, someone's got to get these guys some string to tie around their finger or some post-it notes because they have short-term memory, these Israelites. They're forgetting everything. I mean, I can't remember a phone number except my wife's. I can't remember what to get at the store. I have a terrible memory. But why is God telling them to remember? Because they have a bad memory? No. Because he knows in our humanity we're going to forget. It's okay. To forget is human, but to remember is divine. And here's why. When we remember what God has done for us in the bad times, we remember that God is with us in the bad times. When we remember what God has done for us in the good times, we remember that he's loyal and he's faithful to us in the bad times. God's constantly telling them to remember the same reason he tells you and I to remember, because he knows we're going to forget. Because in our humanity, in our sin, in our fallen nature, in our desire to all be gods and be equal with God and play God in our lives the same way Lucifer wanted to be equal with him, the same way Adam and Eve grasped, in our sinfulness, our humanity, it's really easy to lose perspective. The word perspective is an interesting word too. From the Latin, it means to look through. So having a perspective doesn't mean you just kind of turn your head a little bit and look at something from a different angle. It means you look through a situation. It means you take a higher perspective. The same way in Isaiah, God says, my thoughts are above your thoughts, my ways are above your ways. As high as the heavens are over the earth, are my thoughts over your thoughts, my ways over your ways. You see, when we take a divine perspective, a godly perspective, things change. I remember one morning I was having to take a flight out of Phoenix. It seems like ages ago since anybody was on a flight, right? And it was a pre-sunrise flight. It was really dark outside. And I had to leave my family again to go on a 3-day trip, and I did not want to go. And my heart was heavy, and I was driving, it was raining outside, which, you know, never happens in Arizona. So it was even worse, right? And then, you know, it starts raining, so nobody knows how to drive, and I'm stressed about making my flight. It was just a heavy morning, and I finally get to the airport, and I get through the lines, and I get onto the plane, and the rain's hitting the window, and it's dark outside, and it's gray, and it's gloomy, and I'm really down. I'm upset. I'm angry at the Lord. Why am I having to go do this? I don't want to go on this trip. I don't want to leave my family. And I was heavy, and the darkness was setting in, and I could feel the enemy's claws just on my heart and around my neck, suffocating out all the joy, weighing me down with stress. I had completely forgotten the privilege that it is to get to serve the Lord, to preach his word. That morning, all I could remember was what a horrible thing my life was. And as we took off the runway and we ascended into the clouds, just then the light starts to break. The sun's coming up. And the light's breaking, and just as we get through the clouds, the rain stops, the gray is over, and as we crest through the clouds, all of a sudden, it's bright. It's blinding light, light blinding me through the window. And it was as though God, in his mercy in that moment, this God of light, reached down and said, oh, my son, whack, and hit me right upside the head with a spiritual 2x4. He said, don't you understand? Your perspective is too small. Your perspective on me is not big enough. That I am a God of light. I'm bigger than this darkness. I'm bigger than your darkness. I'm bigger than the darkness that you perceive and that you don't perceive. When you take a divine perspective, when you elevate your thinking, when you pray, prayer, that's what prayer does. Prayer lifts us off the tarmac in the gray and in the rain, out of the self-pity and the isolation and the sadness. the prayer lifts us off that tarmac, out of the gray, above the clouds, as if God's to say, this is how I see things. See, because I'm the God of the universe. I'm the God who loves you. I'm the God who made you, who created you. I'm the reason you're here. Not only am I the reason you're here, I'm the reason that you breathe. I'm the reason you got up this morning. That in taking a higher perspective, you realize that darkness can't overcome the light. That St. John was right. The light always shines in the darkness. And one of my favorite parts about being Catholic is the candle beside the tabernacle. The tabernacle comes from a word that means tent. And the tabernacle, back in the Old Testament, is the tent, the meeting tent, was where they would keep the Ark of the Covenant, where they'd keep God's divine presence. And there's something really fascinating that happens in the book of Exodus. God looks at Aaron, and Aaron is the priest. And he tells Aaron the priest in Exodus chapter 27, verse 20, "You shall order the Israelites to bring you clear oil of crushed olives to be used for the light, so that they may keep lamps burning regularly. From evening to morning, Aaron and his sons shall maintain them before the Lord in the meeting tent." You know, the reason that we have that candle, that glowing candle in the red casing next to the tabernacle, for us Catholics, is to remind us that Christ's true presence, his body and blood, soul and divinity, are inside that tabernacle. It says in John that he came and dwelt among us. He came and pitched a tent and stayed with us, fulfilling his promise in John 6, fulfilling his promise in Matthew 28, fulfilling that he'll never leave us. He'll always be with us. He is Emmanuel. But I love that red candle, constantly flickering, a reminder that even when we can't be together in this church, in this place, that God is still here, that darkness has not won, that the light burns. The light burns brightly. And that's why in every one of our homes, we have that opportunity to let the light burn brightly, to become that light in the darkness, to become that light in the darkness to our neighbors, to coworkers we're separated from, to become the light in our own homes and families and marriages. I know for myself, I have not dealt with quarantine well. I'm not built for it. But every day I wake up and there's a new chance, and there's a new hope, there's a new opportunity to let the light shine. And the more you let your light shine, that empowers people around you to let their light shine. Is it scary right now? Yeah. Is it hard? Yeah. Is it dark out there? Yeah. Is it sad? Yeah. Is there stress and anxiety? Is there death and disease and fear? Yes. Yet we can still come together and worship, because when we see that flickering light, we realize even if every light in this church was off right now, every light we're using, you'd still see that burning light, because the darkness cannot overcome it. And that's why tonight, as we kneel in adoration, as you watch in adoration, you draw near. Yes, you can't physically be here with the Lord of the universe. But through this, we can't all be together, but the family can still come together with one prayer. That the God of light would breathe light again. That we would remind ourselves and remember that we are a resurrection people. That as the light shines upon the light tonight, ask yourself, have I been a light? Have I been immersed in darkness? Have I been trapped in darkness? And do I believe that God will overcome this, that I will overcome this with his power, with his strength? Tonight, pray that God would grant you the virtue, grant you the peace to unleash the hidden greatness of your souls for those around you. And if you're watching this and if you're alone, if you're in solitary, realize that you're not alone, that God is with you. That through this miracle technology, we're all one. Though separated now, we're all one. That the God of the universe, the same God who said, let there be light, the same God who said, I am the light of the world, is still very much alive. That no darkness can overcome him, no darkness can extinguish him. Let's pray for light this night. Let's take a second and pray now as we prepare ourselves. And then Father's going to bring out the Lord. He's going to place the Holy Blessed Sacrament inside what's called a monstrance. The monstrance means to show forth. And we'll see the light radiate from the light. But as we pray now, take a second, wherever you are. Maybe take a moment. Maybe close your eyes. Maybe if you're with a loved one, hold their hand, you know, or open your hands in front of you. And I want to invite you to take a second and ask yourself, do I believe that God has truly got this? Do I believe that the darkness is not greater than God's light? Do I believe that the Lord is risen? that darkness has not won, darkness cannot win, because he promised that the gates of the netherworld would never prevail. Do I believe in the God of the universe? Do I believe in that light that shines in the darkness? Do I believe that darkness cannot overcome it? Ask yourself today, have I been weighed down by things beyond my control, weighed down by those human things? Ask the Holy Spirit. Give the Holy Spirit permission. Say, just please, Holy Spirit, come and elevate my mind, elevate my heart through the rain clouds, through the gray, through the darkness. Give me a new perspective. Give me a divine perspective, Holy Spirit. Give me God's perspective. You know, that light next to the tabernacle, that's God's nightlight. That's his reminder to all of us. When we're fearful, when we're in the dark, the same way for me looking at that light coming out of my Father's room, which helped me to rest peacefully, this is God's way of saying, I'm with you. I would never leave you. I told you, I'll never leave you. Even when you are overwhelmed and overcome, I will never leave you, because you're mine, because you're my son, because you're my daughter, because I love you. That's why Christ said those words in the upper room, do this in remembrance of me. Remember that we can become one again. And even though we can't physically receive the Eucharist right now, we can have a spiritual communion with God the Father. So Lord Jesus, I ask you to bless each and every heart, each and every soul joining with us right now, praying with us right now, or who will watch this later. Lord, be with them. Lord, pour out your sacred blood upon their homes, their families, their sacraments, their communities, God. Lord, protect them from the slings and the arrows of the evil one. Shield them from darkness of heart, fogginess and cloudiness of mind. Lord God, put inside of us an unbearable, unquenching desire to pray more, to trust you, God, to love you more fervently and more deeply. Lord God, alleviate in us the need to feel like we are in control. Holy Spirit, help us to rejoice in not being in control, to rejoice in these sacred moments. Help us to see you in the rising of the sun. Help us to see you in the setting of the sun. Help us to see you, Lord God, in the reflection of the sun that shines in the moon. And Mother Mary and St. Joseph, tonight we ask that you would pray with us when we pray and pray for us when we fail to, that you would kneel beside us and take us by the hand and teach us how to see the light, to take on a new perspective, to see through the darkness. God, our loving Father, you left the light on for us. You gave us the light, begotten, not made. Thank you for that gift, Heavenly Father. Lord Jesus, we love you and we praise you. And Lord, we need you. We need you like we've never needed you before. Come and be a light in our lives, in our homes. Come and breathe your light on us, Lord. We praise you, Jesus. We thank you, God.
Restore every heart that Give me vision to see things like you do. God, I look to you. You're where my help comes from. Give me wisdom. You know just what to do. Forever all my days, I love you.
as we take this moment. We take this moment where here God reveals himself as the bread of life. He reveals his body to us. But wherever it is that we are, God is revealing his love. He's still revealing his life. So we take this moment to take that perspective. That our God, he is life. Our God is love. Our God is with us. Where we are in that moment, and at this moment, stirring in our hearts. He's stirring his love. He's stirring his spirit. We pray, stir your love deeper in us, Lord. Open our hearts to know your light, Lord. God, we pray that right now during this time that we don't miss what you're doing, that we don't miss this moment, that you're calling us deeper into love, that you're calling, you're setting a table for us, even in our own homes, for a feast that you'll provide later. You're setting everything in place, Lord, for something big. For now, pour into the Holy Spirit, we've never even known before. And so we pray that we open our hearts to that. We don't miss you at work right now in our lives, in what you're doing. Even amidst that pain, many of us, we might be alone right now in this moment and we're feeling lonely. But we pray we don't miss you, Lord, that you're with us. Many of us are feeling so anxious about the future, because we have no control over what the next month, what the next year, what the next 10, 20 years are going to look like at this point. But we pray that we don't miss your love at work, your mercy pouring out into our lives. Like the prodigal son, that we can find ourselves wherever it is that we are, and we can instead turn our eyes up to you. And we can run to you, Lord. That we don't miss this moment for that. We don't miss this moment to run to you, Lord. You're calling us deeper. You're calling us deeper. By helping us to come to know ourselves more, the people closest to us more. And you're setting those seeds for a harvest that will be so beautiful. And may we never lose that hope. And so just as the Israelites during the time of the plagues and all of the ways that he poured out that pestilence upon Egypt, that during that time he called them for the first time what they called was Passover. That they began celebrating throughout their entire history, that set the table for that Passover, where on your Last Supper, Lord, you set the table for your disciples and you taught them the way. Do this in remembrance of me. In the darkest times, Lord, you're setting a table for us to pour out your love. And so right now, we open our hearts more to that. We surrender to you, Lord. We surrender all of our control, all of our fears to you, Lord. We pray that you provide healing to areas that are making it difficult for us to be able to let go. Pour out your healing right now, Lord. There's even healings right now in this very moment. Thank you, Lord, for that. Praise you, Lord. In your name, Jesus, thank you, Lord, for those healings. Thank you, Lord, for those healings. And even pour out those physical healings that you desire in this very moment. For anyone who's sick right now, pour out your healing right now, Lord. We pray in Jesus' name, in your name, Lord. We pray most of all that we don't miss this moment of your love outpouring into all of our hearts, into our homes. May it bear fruit, Lord. May it bear great fruit. And so we can rejoice in you when we can recognize that fruit. And we can never let that joy go. So stir up that joy now, Lord. Stir up your love now, Lord, as we sing out to you.
Now I can see your love is better than all the others that I've seen. Now I'm breathing deep all of your goodness, your loving kindness. Is a light that the shadows can't deny. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is alive, forever lifted high. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is alive, and let the shadows dance tonight. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is alive, forever lifted high. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name, and your name is alive, that the shadows can't deny. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is alive, forever lifted high. Your name cannot be overcome. God, Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus. Darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus, silence fear, Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus. Yeah, don't be afraid where you are right now, if with your family, with friends, with your roommates, whoever it is that you're with right now, you can speak out your praise to him. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid of your love. Speak it out, Jesus. Jesus, we thank you. Praise you, God. Darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus, you silence fear, Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus, pour out your light in us. Pour out your light in us.
You have given them bread from heaven.
Permeate all sweetness within it.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, you gave us the Eucharist as the memorial of your suffering and death. May our worship of this sacrament of your body and blood help us to experience the salvation you won for us and the peace of the kingdom, where you live with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
Blessed be God,
blessed be God,
blessed be his holy name,
blessed be his holy name,
blessed be Jesus,
blessed be Jesus,
true God and true man,
true God and true man,
blessed be the name of Jesus,
blessed be the name of Jesus,
sacred heart.
Blessed be his most sacred heart.
Blessed be Jesus.
Blessed be Jesus.
In the sacrament of the altar.
In the sacraments of the altar.
Blessed be the Holy Spirit.
Blessed be the Holy Spirit.
The Paraclete.
The Paraclete.
Blessed be the great Mother of God.
Blessed be the great Mother of God.
Mary most holy,
Mary most holy,
blessed be her holy,
blessed be her holy,
immaculate conception,
immaculate conception,
blessed be her glorious,
blessed be her glorious,
her glorious assumption,
her glorious assumption.
Blessed be the name of Mary,
blessed be the name of Mary,
Virgin and Mother,
Virgin and Mother,
Blessed be Saint Joseph.
Blessed be Saint Joseph.
Her most chaste spouse.
Her most chaste spouse.
Blessed be God.
Blessed be God.
In His angels and His saints.
In His angels and His saints.
Blessed be our great Lord Jesus.
Declare the grave has no claim on me.
Has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope.
What came to be through him was life. And this life was the light of the human race. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. It's 1 John, verse 5. We want to thank you for inviting us into your homes and into your lives tonight. It truly is a privilege, and we know that. So thank you for being with us, to pray with us, to praise with us. We invite you to continue being part of our community as you are able. We live stream masses here every day. Morning masses at 8:30 and then two masses on the weekend. We have Father John who prays a rosary every night live on Facebook. Our musicians lead praise and worship on Tuesday mornings on Instagram. And even on our St. Timothy Life Teen page, we lead morning prayer and night prayer at 9 a.m. and 9 p.m. every single day as an opportunity to interact with you. Our staff is praying over your prayer intentions every single day. Our whole staff receives them every single day. So when you connect, when you let us know how we can pray for you, we promise that we are. So we thank you again for being with us tonight. We look forward to being able to celebrate the resurrection together, hopefully sometime soon, and we'll continue praying with you. Amen.
King, come let us bow at his feet. He has done great things. See what our Savior has done. See how his love overcomes. He has done great things. He has done great things. Conquer the grave, you free every captive and break every chain. Oh God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh God, you have done great. Thank you.
You free every captive and break every chain. Oh.